shirt, the Facebook sounds and stuff.
Yeah.
By the way, I'm trying to find a way to see where people can write the stuff, right?
There is a group chat, right?
Yeah, there is a group chat, but how do people join in?
How do people join in?
Yeah.
I think this is something that I actually never really tested, because essentially, you know, if you're a viewer, a spectator,
because
they're not going to come here and join us in this virtual studio, right? They're just the audience. Our audience is just our audience, but I'm not sure if they can chat, or whether it's only us who can chat. I never tested that aspect of Hangout on Air, but hang on, I might actually use the same trick that I used already once, which is the I'm going to join with, or I'm going to click on the link that you sent me. Using okay. different. Oh, but maybe that's the other. No, can you send me the link that you sent out to people?
I just sent. I just sent like the direct link for YouTube.
Which is.
I'll send you through Skype.
Yeah. Please do, and now I can. Yeah, very good. And I can see what it looks like in a second window, so to speak. Yeah, I can see myself. Oh dear.
Well, people are pinging, at least in Twitter and Facebook, saying you have to log in to use the chat with your
and
Google.
And by the way, I think you actually need to. To switch to your picture.
Or, I need to switch to my picture. Okay.
Well, right now I am.
You're not smoking anymore. So.
Indeed. And I am right now I'm the friendly host, more or less.
More or less.
Talking head. Okay. So when I'm the talking head, I can say that we are going to do some Typerobics, right?
Okay, right.
So what's Typerobics? Remind me. What is Typerobics?
So, you want to go there right now?
With just suddenness. Oh, okay. You mean, well.
I don't know. Maybe I was kind of. I was trying to see how can I share. Well, how can people join the chat, which is weird.
Right. Okay.
So we have 4 visitors, and does that mean that you guys can write in the chat?
Possibly the 4 watching now, possibly on your plus Google Plus or something. What do you think?
Oh, Google, make this easier.
Yeah, it is a bit, confusing.
So I don't know. Can if you guys are hearing us, can you put comments over YouTube? I don't know the link or something. If you guys are watching on YouTube, can you just comment there and see if something happens? Or
show less, show more. There is. I don't think there is a. I don't. It doesn't seem like there is an ability to. Comment
on YouTube. I have comments.
No, there is. Hi, chat. Hang on. Hello. There is a different chat. Oh, that's weird. There's a different. Oh, so this is. So basically, the chat on YouTube is a separate chat from the group chat that we have here.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. They say ahoy. See my comment question. I can be moderating the chat. So okay, you can concentrate on your magic, doing the magic. And okay, so if
okay, so and that would be okay, but if I want to see that, where can I see that?
It's if you go to the YouTube link. And on the YouTube link, when YouTube opens, there is a chat.
Okay, awesome. So, hey, Christopher, and hey, Stefan, and hey to the other ghost visitors who are just too shy to come in. So,
we have 5 people watching now,
which is awesome.
Which is fantastic. Awesome,
because I'm doing this completely impromptu. So I have to stop doing that with my chair. And okay, so. I'm doing this completely on impromptu because I was just delaying this over and over again. So maybe this is the best way to do so.
Yes. So.
So here's.
Hello, everyone. So hello. Everyone. We have 7 people watching now. Great. We have 7 people. Hello, all the live audience. welcome to the 100th. Typerobics edition. I'm Adam Twardoch, and the hero of the evening is Fábio Duarte Martins, and he's a type designer, and he's an activist of sorts, and has many other talents. Among others, he started doing this Typerobics sessions at the beginning of this year. Right? It was February or something like that, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think so.
So it's now, half a year and 100 sessions, 100 typographic exercises that you do more or less every day.
Exactly.
6 months, 100 sessions. It might not be every single day, but it's decent. It's very decent.
Yeah, it's decent, especially the last 2 weeks, because I was getting near to this 100 thing, and I've been overloaded with work, so I kind of lost these 2 weeks out of Typerobics, but we're back. So and this is the best part. So, okay, so I should explain what Typerobics is, and
yes.
But first. First of all, I should explain who Adam Twardoch is. Aha! So, since he introduced me, I'll introduce you. So, Adam is a major tech geek, specialized in type and fonts and the software for type and fonts and stuff. Okay, Adam works as a Adam works in Font Lab. He's a product manager for Font Lab. I'm saying this right?
That's absolutely correct.
Okay. And the reason why Adam is here is, well, first, we already did one of these sessions via Font Lab. And I asked Adam to join us again because, first of all, we're using Font Lab. And he knows it inside out, and it's a selfish reason, because when I do this with Adam's seeing the thing, every time I get to learn something new and something that is actually very, very cool for me. So
yeah, I hope that some of our plus, of course, you know, I'm basically here to help you get over the tough moments where you have to massage a curve somewhere and you can't talk and do at the same time. Although you actually can do it very well, but in these cases, I can tell a funny anecdote and let you conceal the horrible mistakes you're making, for instance.
And the main reason is that we just like to goof around, right?
Indeed, we do.
So we have 9 people there. It's a crowd.
It's eight people for me. Maybe you have some secret.
No, maybe it's, I do.
There is a slight delay, I must say. So it's not 100% live. It's quite funny, actually, because, you know, I say something, I make a gesture, and then I see sort of a few seconds later, I see the picture on the side doing the gesture. Anyhow, we should get going. So
we should get going, exactly.
So just Typerobics. What's the idea of, okay, you're doing it every day or every couple of days, and
yeah,
what is it?
Well, Typerobics is a workout. Basically, it's a type design workout. It is built for a fast improvement of type design skills, especially the drawing part. And the goal is to do a micro typeface, or basically a word worth of glyphs, and for me under 40 minutes. So that's rule number one. Rule number two is always publish, but even if it's crap, and that's it. I think it's pretty much it.
Well, I don't believe that it's true, because, you know, I've seen the archive of the stuff you did, and I sort of assume, well, there are a few ones that aren't so strong, but most of them are good. And my impression is it's probably still the handpicked 10%, and you actually have 1,000 of them. Most of them are utter crap, and you only show the ones that are good. But you say that you're showing all.
Another thing. Yeah, I don't have anything else to do. You know?
Okay, remind me, you pick a style and you pick a word and you start drawing, right? In Fontab Studio 5.
Yeah.
So what do we do with the word?
Go on. You're the host. So
I was thinking the audience, they can maybe throw in a few suggestions for the word, not too long a word, but also maybe an interesting one, you know, that has a couple of different letters and a style, and we'll see comes from that. Our vast audience of age grade followers. I hope that we'll be joined by crowds so what tools do you use normally? You use some sort of a random word.
Random word generator. I can show people. So let me just deal with this Hangouts thing. So here we go. Can you see it?
I can see your screen, yes.
Okay, so let me see if everything's going well on YouTube. This has some delay, so I don't know.
It does. But it's gonna come.
Come out.
Come up, yeah. Don't worry. Be patient.
Okay, so actually the website is wordgenerator.net, and they have a lot of, they have three generators, but basically I use this one. Even though, I don't know if for this session you should do something special. I don't know, you guys, well, use the chat and say, and please let us know if there's something that you suggest. But anyway, I'm going to look for a word.
Maybe you should click on your own. Can you click on your own icon somewhere in the Hangout on Air director's panel?
Oh.
Yeah, because although, hang on, if I see...
Can you hear?
That's the thing. Well, it's hard to say because there's still a bit of a delay, and I can pick what I see as the participant, but the people on air, they can only see what you've picked out of the little screens at the bottom. That's how it works, I believe.
Yeah, but it should be me. I see the right now. I'm seeing the.
Oh yeah, I can see your screen. Okay. Now. So basically, yeah, now it's good.
Okay. So now, okay, then we're going there. Okay, so guys, sorry for the mess. We just
messing around.
This is very new.
Hang on. Yeah.
Okay. So. Okay, word. I just click through and search for a word. You're keeping an eye on the chat, right?
Yeah.
So you know, if people are suggesting stuff, are you guys suggesting anything?
At this point, we don't have suggestions. So we might try the
Nomenclature.
This is some. Yeah, we do skip. Tend to skip diseases, right, or something.
Yeah, we do.
Or words that sound like diseases.
A white grape steamed for the table. What is this supposed to mean?
A white grape esteemed for the table. I have no idea. Well, esteemed for the table. It's probably some kind of a sort of grape that you make wine from.
Okay. That could work, actually. I don't know. Let's see. Pedicel. No. No, too short. Maybe
so. Butler is a nice. Okay, acid. Well, I did like butler, but butler is a nice.
Butler.
Yeah, you know, the guy who serves you.
Yeah, the butler, yeah. But then, I don't know. Maybe it's too short. Oh, okay.
Nice. Butler is nice.
Okay, butler.
You know, you could spend a bit more time on the polishing the detail and not sort of try to run ahead. It has everything that is interesting, I think.
Okay, so if so, let's go to FontLab Studio. Okay, okay, now you can see it, right?
Yes.
Okay, so we need butler. And what style are we going to do today?
Yeah, that's...
Butler calls for a formal script, doesn't it?
Butler?
Yeah.
It could be formal script. It could be certainly not some sans serif stuff. I mean, it could be either formal, slightly condensed, light serif, or it could be a script.
Huh.
Let's do a script, maybe, because the last time
we did a sort of a
boldish serif, so let's do script. It's gonna be nice.
I think so also. And oh, so let's start by doing a trick that actually Adam told me to. So it should be around here. So it should be this slant angle thing. So for a formal script, let's do 30 degrees. Yeah, let me see how that works. So 30 degrees, maybe too much.
How much did you set?
30. But I think I'll just.
You know what? I think what you might need to do is to, because you're probably in some font info or something right now, but it's not visible.
Oh.
Because the screen sharing, you probably picked the FontLab Studio window. And you really need to pick the screen, which
I'm
is
just
a bit
going to show like full screen and that's it, and do some psychedelic stuff. Can you see it now? My screen.
It's coming. Yes, I mean, I now see the psychedelic stuff. Woo! So yeah.
Okay. So and now you can.
Yeah, see that's coming. Much better. Yes. Yes.
Okay. Okay. Excellent. So we're well now. So I was trying with 30, but I think this is probably way too much right now. So 20 degrees inclination. Yeah, that might work.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So let's say with 20. And
so what it does, the function for the slant parameter, basically you allows you to draw upright strokes, but it sort of slants them on the fly, right?
Exactly. And if you can be more specific on why, that would be nice.
Well, it's essentially, it's a... first of all, it's a feature that is built into the OpenType, the CFF, the PostScript format, and has always been as part of Type 1. Basically, it's as we know, you know, the working with sort of italic typefaces in pretty much any tool, you have some limitations. You can't really move easily things up and down or actually along the slant axis. With keyboard, you need to sort of measure these steps. You need to go, okay, so many units up and then some to the right or to the left to keep a consistent slant angle. And even if you have like slanted guidelines or grids, it's still not as efficient as I think using this trick, which is basically, at least to some extent, you can, you know, draw upright, so it's very easy to use rectangles and basic shapes, and you see how the automatic on-the-fly slanting works, and at some point you can actually apply the slant later and do the final touch-ups, etc. So it's a, yeah, so it's not the same as the italic angle. The italic angle that you set in Font Info, that basically only informs the system that the font is italic and also slants the text cursor, the caret, so to speak, the one that appears when you're editing text. But the slant angle is actually a slant that is being applied to the drawings during the rasterization of the font.
I couldn't have said it better myself, because actually I don't know. So
that's the slant. It's been used originally by some Adobe early Type 1 fonts. Basically, an oblique font was pretty much exactly the upright font, but just with the slant applied, and they used the same outlines, and it was easier for hinting. Because the hints were applied to upright strokes. These days, it's not really used much, but as a design tool, I think it is quite useful.
Oh, it is. Well, at least for my part, I've studied, you know, when I go to design italics or slanted type, in any way, I'm using this like every time, because it's just... It doesn't mean that I'm not going to correct it later on. It's just that, you know, for me, design wise, since I have the preview window always open, you know, it's just way easier for me, you know, to have the angle constraints and, like, for example, this thing of having the handles horizontal or vertical. For me, it's just so intuitive to work this way. But,
yeah, I agree. And I think it's, you know, it allows you to sort of really see instantly. I mean, we are, you know, if something is perfectly horizontal or vertical, then we sort of see it instantly. And if it's slanted, even if there's a slanted grid or you apply slanted guidelines to something, it's still not as efficient. And of course you know, here, you move things up and down with either mouse or cursor keys, and it goes up and down. It doesn't do something that you wouldn't expect. So I see that you're using the grid. What did you step? What is your grid step here? 10? No.
It's 1 in 10.
Ah, okay. So
one for 10. The nudge. And...
Right. So it's 10.
The grid step is 50 units.
Oh, all 50. Right. Okay. So your stems are now 100 units, basically, the thick part. Okay.
I'm not thinking much about it because, well, this is not going to leave a screen. So I'm not very worried right now about the width, even though it does. Well, this does look a bit too dark for me.
I agree.
So I'm just going to 75. That's it. I know that Butler doesn't have an eye. I'm just using this as a as an initial module.
Mm-hmm.
So because I can get a lot of shapes out of this. And the cool thing about formal script is that it's pretty much regular. Once you have a good setting or a good rhythm for these for this first module. I don't know the name actually.
The name module is basically for these not loops but the connections and the straights and the rounds.
Yeah, the terminals or the
mm-hmm.
Wherever you one feels well about calling them
arcs and columns.
So I think it's it's 75.
Your L, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this is my. I might do something in the terminal.
Yeah.
I'm just looking for it right now. So.
A cauliflower or a tulip or a lily.
Okay, so this should be. Okay, so it's 10 here? Yeah, 10. So. 10 and he has 50 on the other one, so this should be less 60. Yeah. And I can delete these. So, you can go straight away for the T or the initial shape of the T. Maybe too much. And TNL should be around 60. How have you been? We haven't been talking much.
I've been busy on working on a unnamed font editor for the next version of the thing that you're working on, which actually is more like an uber much far than a next version. It's the plus 5. It feels like it's gonna be FontLab 10 or it's really wonderful. I still can't talk too much about it, but it is absolutely fantastic. And it's one of the things is that when I watch you work, it's sort of like, oh, okay, this is nice, because it sort of you can still work this way, of course, in the next FontLab, but you can also do certain things sort of much faster and more convenient. So I think it's going to be fun. I it's been wonderful. It's been just having this ability to contribute ideas and see how this environment develops, the drawing tools and navigation and just the whole user interface. It's fantastic. And well, I must say quite a few things, especially the drawing, is just incredible. In terms of once you've worked with them, you don't really wanna go back to any other drawing tool that use Beziers, because these are nice Beziers. But anyhow, this is
not already pitching.
Well, you know,
You should.
Well, I mean, you know, it really is genuinely exciting and good. So I hope that that people will also find it this way. Okay, I see. Yeah, that is a nice U, actually, I must say.
It's not that bad, right?
It is. I must say, you know, I sometimes ask, because you have when you're doing these arcs in many of your typefaces, you have a certain, let's say, tendency to give them a certain dynamic. And in this particular case, I think actually even, well, I'm not going to try to. Maybe next time. You know, you basically, I've seen that you've been wary of trying to do these arcs in a more kind of circular way. You always, you know, you always give this fast dynamic and this asymmetric sort of speed of the curve, and I wondered whether, you know, this almost has become a
trademark.
I would be inclined to use the word tick.
Yeah, it's probably a tick.
But also trademarks, surely. But, you know, something that I might, you know, this. I think it's also a wonderful
tick.
You know, a wonderful type of, you know, typerobics sort of exercise. A great way to, first of all, sort of discover your own sort of regularities, you know, whether it's trademarks or ticks or and then just become aware of them, and then, you know, maybe decide, okay, maybe I'm gonna stick to them because I like this particular movement tackle that I do with the curves, or maybe it's time to actually try something sort of radically different, and, you know, face a new challenge. So I think it's nice to, you know, to observe this in your own development, right? When you can, I don't know, look back at these exercises and perhaps see, okay, is there something that I'm doing in a repetitive way, or is it a convention? Is it something that I want to stick to, or maybe not? I'm not saying, of course, you should, because in the end, it's just interesting that every time I see these, you know, round elements that you do, that you end up arriving at a. Is it really? This looks like FFP2, actually, the typeface that he had does. But I might, you know, maybe you would maybe,
I don't know if I would slant them a little bit.
Yeah, perhaps or do a reverse. Maybe on the left you could do something on the left one, no? Because I'm gonna, you know, the left one become curvy, the left stem of the U.
Yeah, it might. I don't know. I was just messing and see how that could work out, and just realized not well. But but anyhow. Nah, leave it. It's
absolutely
good. So, but yeah, about the ticks. Well, I think you're right. I think one actually develops those ticks, either one wants to or not. So, yeah, this could be a way, you know, to back off a little bit and see if you're doing something nice or not, or if you're being too repetitive, of course.
Mm-hmm.
But thanks. That was actually a very how can I say, a very dodgy and sympathetic way to call me on my own crap. So.
Well, you know, it's
to have your talent.
Basically, you know, this. I don't know if I told you this. This anecdote, or actually, I said it maybe already, because it's a great one. It's when that Maxim Zhukov told me, you know, the great typographic director of the United Nations for 20 something years he was.
Yeah.
He told me this story where he was in charge of printing of the UN materials in all the languages. So, you know, multilingual typography made to the extreme. And he once supervised some publication to be printed in some languages. And, well, there was something happened either with the typesetting or the printing. In any case, the documents arrived and his boss came to him with the documents, showed a particular page where there was something strange. And he said, Maxim, is this a fuck up or is this a decision? And then Maxim was silent for a few seconds and said, well, it's a fuck up. But he offered him, you know, a choice. Basically, it could have been a decision, albeit a rather unorthodox one, or a fuck up. And often I think, you know, it is really the decisions in this type of design, especially in type design, where, you know, if you do everything by the book, then you end up with the same result as everybody else's, right? You make a yet another. So then you sort of start maybe looking for some quirks and some trademark elements, and if you overdo them, then it sort of starts becoming, you know, artificial and forced, and maybe a bit too limiting. And I remembered, and I was talking to some type designer who basically told me that, you know, whenever he's doing a corporate typeface, he basically does them in a grotesque way, not in a typographic sense, but actually in the original sense, just completely overdrawn certain elements, exaggerated, so that the managers at the company who commissioned the typeface can look at it and said, oh yes, this is our font, because it's visibly different from the others. If these differences were too subtle, then they asked him, was like, well, how is it different from, you know, Times or something? So if he makes a pronounced dodgy curve on some elements, he says, see, this is the trademark bulge on the curve, and they seem to see it. So for release typefaces, he basically does them in a more conventional way and kind of more balanced. And if it's corporate, then they seem exaggerated. And you can see with some of the type designers, they actually do just that, because they have essentially, you know, realized at some point that the even though for the general public or the reader, this particular trait is a bit exaggerated, for the people who commissioned it, for the client, it needs to be there, because it needs to be the special flavor, you know, it's super salty or super sweet.
Even if you can tone it down afterwards, you know, because that's the thing, you know, like the small iterations. I can get that, because also, you know, the small iterations, people are not that aware of them. Yeah, sorry.
This is, by the way, my favorite part, when you're building something like an E from completely crappy elements and then sort of trying, because I think it's an interesting, you know, I think it's an interesting experience to sort of see how something good looking sort of is emerging at almost the last moment. I mean, with straighter shapes, you basically can get to see where it's going earlier. But I think with these round things, you kind of, depending on how people draw, You need to wait until the very end, and for a long, long time, it sort of looks like it's going nowhere or actually in a bad direction. And I hope that maybe in, well, I actually strongly hope that with FontLab 6, this will become a bit easier because, what you are doing right now will not be the only way to draw. There will be better ways, but I see that some of our viewers ask when will the release, the FontLab 6 will be released, and I must say that I can't talk about this yet, but
you're trying to.
But there will be. It's in good shape, but you know, I'm not saying anything because I won't spoil. There's still some work to be done, but it's just shaping up better and better every day. So,
how many people do we have on the?
We have 10 people watching.
This is crazy.
It's loud. And then of course, though, 11. Just
11. Just now.
Just now.
Hello, 11.
Now that is a really. Okay, now I am actually really, really now interested in how you're gonna solve this, because I must say, you know, to some extent I remember that my good friend Łukasz Dziedzic was also drawing his initial version of Pito in a similar fashion, with using the slant parameter and doing the uprights. And of course, when you do it, you sort of have to design, especially the round elements, in a slightly sort of distorted fashion, right? I mean, it has to look a bit weird when it's upright to look it right. So you need to sort of consult, of course, because exactly. So the contrast sort of looks a bit odd in your glyph window, but in the preview panel, it looks right. So it's an interesting. I actually enjoy, you know, looking at these sort of uprighted italic forms, because they sort of reveal. I think more. I mean, they allow you to actually understand what you're doing. It's weird, right? Because it's almost like this technique that some people apply, that they flip some letters and make them and look at them upside down.
Yeah.
If you're working with contrast and you're actually working with contrast this way, then you're gonna spot inconsistencies much faster. Really? Oh yeah. Okay. Interesting.
Because I forgot this was supposed to be connected. So I just forgot about it. And now I'm trying to get it back. Maybe I can get a more interesting curve.
But it's very it's looking very wide now compared to. And you think it's really wide compared to the U and stuff. I mean, it should be a bit more. I would say the counter of the E needs to come down, certainly. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And now you can. That's kind of nice. What if you pull up the middle bar, the two nodes in the middle bar a bit? Just because I think this always has the most dramatic, you know, the dramatic change. I feel that this kind of, you know, experimenting with this, you know, where to put this middle bar has the biggest impact on how letter forms look. I'm a big fan of, you know, experimenting with basically the loop in the lowercase a and the loop in the lowercase e, where just changing this counter has such a massive change of the perception of the rest, right? Because it's the So yeah, I would kind of urge you to make it smaller. It would just look. Just pull it up.
Too happy.
Yeah, just have it. It would be. Yeah, it's sort of cooler, I think. When you're a bit more grand in there.
And I think this guy should go forward, actually. I need some extra points. Otherwise, I'm not going to tackle this. So here we go.
I would actually move the two top points a bit to the left to make them a bit. That's sort of the, you seem to prefer a bit more of this asymmetric tension.
Yeah.
And I'm kind of like, it's like, hand, basically, because if it's a formal script, then I feel that.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
There should be a bit more.
I'm digressing, yeah.
But yeah, sorry, I
No, but I do agree with you. I'm kind of digressing from the initial pitch. So, and maybe this guy from script. Well, this is a kind of a.
I just saw the comments by Stefan here that which actually addresses my teasing to FontLab 6 release. He says, "Come on, it's just us listening."
Yeah, but this is when you laugh.
It will be all over the internet after we're finished. It will be recorded and transmitted, and it will be on NBC News tomorrow.
And you cannot trust type journalists.
Oh, no, especially.
They are a dangerous bunch.
Yeah, especially the French. I would never trust the French journalists.
I don't know. Do we have anyone from France? How many people do we have?
We have 10 people.
10 people. Of those 10, is anyone French?
If you're French, please speak out or type into the... You could use your French. Well, I must say, our linguistic division goes pretty decent. You're sort of fabulous in Portuguese and Spanish and French. In English we meet, and I sort of then continue with German and Russian and things like that. I think it's a...
Polish,
yes, of course. Thank you. I almost...
Just to remind you where you come from. So.
Yeah. That's a good point. Well, of course, you tend to... think of your mother tongue yourself as something different, like a different kind of animal, right? It's like, or actually more like a person, as if my English and my German and my Russian, they're more like pets of sorts, but the Polish is more like, my brother or mother or something. It's I think it does actually, as has been proven sort of by some researchers, that the mother tongue sits in a different area of the brain than the languages that you learn later. So and there is a break at between around 3 or 4 years old. But basically, any language that you start learning after you're 3 years old, it's going to go to the other. To the other brain, basically. Oh, now, of course, once you've done this kind of a E, you will have to correct those other joints, right? I do like the
Well, at some point I will.
Yeah, good. Because I do like the more sort of rigid and formal contrast that you did in the E. But then these arches in the other...
Well, I was just getting that feeling that I was insisting on it, which is not very good. But so that's why I just moved on to something else, and then I'll get back and then see what I can do. Because the thing is that's the first round shape, so I don't have this looks bad, so I don't have much information on on what I can do, so I'm trying to figure out what's doable here.
Are you gonna do the sort of the reverse French type of R, the one with the starting with a blob and then going
and then going and then down.
That's what you're aiming for, right, or not?
Actually, I don't know.
Because I don't know if you ever tried it, but you might. That would be actually nice. You know, I don't know if you've done it before, this type of R. You know, the one that looks like a... Cyrillic G.
Hold on. Where are the... Oh, I just opened them. Okay. Let me get these up. What do you mean, like this? Or
no, I mean the one where you start...
With the loop.
And yeah.
Well, I don't know. Actually, I was going for that, but...
Okay.
I was going for that, but then it reminded me of this, and I don't know if with the rest of the composition that would work best. but I don't know.
Well, I would say it would, you know, it's certainly this loop in the middle between the E, at the junction between the E and the R, that loop, however you solve it, the little blob or something, it will certainly live in, it would, you know, it would liven things up. If you do a traditional R, like the one on the left that you drew, mm-hmm. that sketched you, then it's going to be, again, sort of modular, won't it? It will be kind of...
Yeah, it will. It will. Choices. Sorry about that. I'm going to skip the R completely. Because I think I'm going to do just out of the R.
Okay.
This might have to be better. Because I don't know. I think like even if you were doing if you were doing like a full character set for this,
the screen sharing has gone off, or maybe not, but
did it? Psychedelic. Are you not seeing it?
Ah, now it's back. Okay. It is here.
So
it was okay. Yeah. There was something.
If I were to do a typeface, like a formal script typeface, most likely the ER should be a ligature because the connection would be too stiff, I think, with this kind of property. So let us aim for a flowy thing and see how this goes. Up this way, I can. Up this, so this would be on the left. So I'm trying. I'm making sounds, stupid sounds.
So no, don't worry about it.
I'm not. I'm doing it. So and I do have fun with it. I don't have much of a problem of making an idiot out of myself. So.
That looks like a part of an Indic character. Well,
not it does. It does. Didn't you know? But I was going.
But are you going to make a blob there, like a dark blob? Okay. I'm just.
The reason why I'm doing this is just I'm at this point I'm mostly worried about the flow of the stroke.
Yeah.
Then you know if it's dark, it's not as contrast. You know, this is actually it's not one of the easiest shapes to do.
Well, but if we only tried for the easy, where would we be, right?
Of course. Now you're talking.
We need to aim high and far.
Actually, I remember this. I reminded myself of you of one of our conversations yesterday, because the name of the role was playing on TV, and I remember that you read that recently.
Yeah, I actually just finished it a few days ago. I had a kind of the last few chapters where because I already knew the resolution of the riddle in The Name of the Rose, I wasn't so driven to learn who's done it, right? Because I already knew who'd done it because I've seen the film and before, but so I had a break of about, I don't know, a month or something until I finished the last few chapters. But yeah, I recently finished, and it was really a good experience, and I enjoyed the middle now, much more, because it was actually the whole debate and the philosophical sort of the coming of age discussions between Atzo and William of Baskerville that were very nice to follow, and it was a nice book to sort of to guide me through the summer.
Very nice. So
that looks like a nice loop, generally, I must say.
Okay, so thanks. And something went wrong with your sound. Can you speak a little bit more?
Can I?
Oh, you're fine now.
Okay, good. Nuno Dias says, tell Fabio I'm saying hello from Portugal.
Hello, Nuno. So, did you just arrive now?
He spoke up now, but he may have been watching. Oh yeah, he said I just saw this little window to talk, so he probably didn't see the chat window before.
But, okay.
Oh yeah, okay. That's now it's really ugly, but it's gonna change. For a moment, I like this. I like this this flow where you have to, screw up things to fix them later. It's sort of a nice nice flow. I think it's a...
Yeah. Well, it is. It's kind of decent-ish.
It's too far, though, right? I would put it...
Too far from where?
From the E.
Yeah, you think so?
Yeah, given this, the inner spacing of the other ones, I think the gap between the E stems and the R stems is...
Right. You're absolutely right. I'm just afraid that once that goes...
You're going to screw up your beautiful loop? Oh, don't worry about it. You can... Yeah. No, I think, I think the junction between the loop and the R needs to be reduced a lot. The loop in the R, I think the R... The stem basically almost needs to almost touch the knob. So the R stem should go in.
I would say.
Yeah,
I think you're right. I think you're absolutely right.
Even more. Just a bit more. But make the loop. Basically, move it in more. I would say move it in more. Yeah. Okay. And now move the loop a bit closer to the R, because that can, because it belongs really with the R. It shouldn't belong. Yeah.
But that's the thing. Even though here, I think it's too close. Actually, this should be more steep, definitely.
Possibly. Yeah.
Well, maybe not. Maybe it doesn't need that kind of adjustment.
Yeah, don't move it ahead. That was good. That was good. It was principally good. It's now this deceptive a bit when you Yeah, because the yeah, okay. Yeah, I think it's all right. You also might, you know, heighten the sort of the R stem a bit, that it sort of doesn't cut off.
There's no, not, this guy.
Yeah. Well, I would leave the loop, sort of make it. Yeah. Just, you know, find a decent. I mean, they do belong together in the end. I mean, they're not the bridge between the, you know, the, I think the blob and the stem shouldn't be too. It's not an apostrophe between two letters. You know what I mean? It's
the, yeah, sort
of the left,
yeah,
part, sure, of still that letter. So
yeah, well, I do believe you're right. So. Huh. Okay, let me just test out. Well, I guess I'm going to cheat a little bit here.
You're gonna cheat?
Yeah. I'm doing,
that's okay, it's all about cheating anyway.
It is. So just to fill that loop.
Yeah.
Just for me to see how.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it does change the perception a lot.
Yeah. Yeah, and it makes me.
It's
wanna,
too big.
Yeah.
It is too big.
It is.
It's a bit too big. It should be about 23% smaller.
Yes, because we have numbers like that. Oh man. Oh. But you know, well, we make a joke out of it, but actually there are a lot of people that, and oh man, I'm forgetting how to speak English. It's not good. Even I had some, well, for some time I was trying to find out those kind of solutions, which are pointless, you know, to know exactly. So how much should I compensate, or how much should I do this? Like having a precise mathematical solution for everything.
Can you, by the way, if you just did something, what if you the left part of the loop, the inner counter, if you moved it in so that to create, but only the left part, like take the node, the left, take the inner counter of the loop, and move, but only the one node, the inner node, and move it
like
along.
Like having
yeah,
the process like that.
Yeah, I was just because it just occurred to me that it could somehow.
Yeah, it could work. It looks like those.
You know, make it even more pronounced, so it actually is sort of going more towards the stem thickness, but actually having a loop there rather than this blob. You know, because it is a calligraphic.
Quirk. Yeah, that might work. It reminds me of those, you know, like 30s American cartoon stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm. You know, I'm not. I think it. At least it's. You know, it's something that I thought. Yeah, that could be.
Yeah. Yeah, but this has to be smaller.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes.
Smaller than this. And this guy has to go down.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah, look like that.
It does look a bit like Mickey Mouse stuff, but.
Yeah, it does. Maybe it's me.
Looks like a golf club a bit. In the zoom, you know, it sort of reminds me of the shape of the golf club. Not that I have my last golf game that I was.
Oh, I never played golf.
No,
I
played mini golf once, and I lost badly. So.
Well, it's better. It's like the mini golf. It's the grown up version of golf, right?
Is it?
I don't know. I think
it's the other way around, but
It's the not uptight version of it.
True, yes. And you don't have to take your trolley. There's something wrong with the angle of this arm, the stem. I think it should be more
about this slanted. Stem.
The R stem.
You think so? Yeah, I've tried that a bit. Yeah.
Yeah, and move it in. It's far too far away. Just move the whole bloody thing closer to the Mickey Mouse.
Were you thinking of something like that?
No. That was good. But just tilt it a bit and move the whole thing closer to the loop. It's just far too. Well, that's a bit too much. But no, that's too much, of course. But, you know, there was. No, that.
Oh, there's a lady coming out of it, you know, like
yes, there is a lady. Yes,
and then you have the hair, and so.
Very bizarre. Yeah, that's just no, but stop. Yeah, somewhere.
You think so? Around here? I'm not sure.
It's just that this guy. Now it's it has to be closer. Yeah. And now close the bloody loop. I mean, this Mickey Mouse effect is no good. It needs to go, basically. It has to be a solid blob.
Yeah, it has. It doesn't have to. But I'm trying just to. That is Mickey Mouse. Okay, now what the fuck am I doing?
That is a completely different. That is.
I don't know. Yeah, I do prefer going here, actually. I'm not sure about the loop.
Don't move it. Yeah, like stop moving it to the right. Basically, just not too much because it. I'm not saying move it to the left. It's good. It's good now. But it's and now the bloody loop is. You're trying to establish this. I don't think you're trying to establish this distance, this bridge between the blob and the R. And I. Maintain that the blob should be much closer to the R. It's just my. But what do I know? I'm not a.
I don't know.
It was nice. He's now.
But if this goes that.
Now it's. People, the,
people must have. Having fun with it.
Yeah. You're moving it away.
I'm looking for stuff. Don't worry.
Yeah. Okay. Well, you can be. You can be looking in your cellar for a car, but cars aren't usually parked in cellars. They're in garages. So
cars aren't usually.
Oh, yeah. That's okay. That starts looking. Just if you get rid of this bloody hole in the middle, black, it will really good. It will start looking.
Beast. I will. Actually, that wasn't my plan. But I'm just I have to flatten the curve so I can get it out. Even though I'm still not convinced. And,
well, you could make it a slightly. You could reduce it vertically though, from the top. It's a bit too. I feel that it's a bit too exaggerated. The loop. The loop should be a bit shorter. Yeah. Now it's sort of getting the.
Man, I gotta tell you, I love your excitement, man. Oh.
Yeah, it looks sort of it looks decent. It looks okay. And if you could enlarge, you could change the angle at the E at the bottom where the thin part starts to make it a bit more square. Just to make it a bit more square so the angle comes up a bit more abruptly. Just even a bit more abruptly. Just try to make it even a bit more vertical.
I would.
Yeah. Just to the right, and so it actually goes. Yeah, but it's already.
Yeah, I see what you mean. I see what you mean. Yeah. But even though it's, I don't know. I don't think it's too rigid, isn't it? Oh, I don't know. Maybe it is.
But it's, you know, generally it is.
Look at it, like the upright version is ugly as hell.
Yeah, of course, but you can't look at the upright version. Well, I would really do it, try to do it a bit more square, but that's just my, you know, just move the handle to the right and move the other handle to the right of the other stroke. So it sort of goes, you know, down, 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 up, and not with the smooth, but more like a, you know, slightly flatter horizontally and then slightly more vertical.
Okay.
Yeah. Very good. Yeah. That's
good at this, right?
you mean the
following instructions.
Yes, I didn't want to say that out loud, but no, I really like it. It's it has the right rhythm now, and you could actually move the whole R even a bit closer to the E.
That indeed, because it's the thing. I kind of enjoy this, but I'm not enjoying this
much. Uh-huh.
Okay, so maybe.
Yeah, it also is a bit black there, right?
Yeah, it is.
It's far too black.
Apparently, it's far too black.
But if you take the R part, including the loop, the whole R section, and move it a bit to the left, closer to the E, then it might resolve. Yeah, just maybe a bit close, but you know what I mean, right?
Yeah, I know what you mean. But I have to soften this tension.
Mm-hmm.
That's about all right. Maybe this has to get a little back. I think I'm taking this is taking me way more than 40 minutes. I completely lost the track of time right by now. So
yeah, that's because we're always so chatty.
I know.
Too much. We should be like just doom, 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 do it. And like, yeah, okay, well, next. No fun, just work.
That would skip the. I think that would miss. That would miss the whole point of doing this live. So.
Yeah, of course. And what does it? It reminds me now of something. Oh yeah, I know what it reminds me of. Budweiser. For some reason, let me check the Budweiser logo. I think it.
You think the Google guys did it, right?
Okay, no, the Budweiser logo looks different. But although the Czech one is the Budweiser. Budvar is the. It's a completely different. It's just the ER, you know, the ER ending.
Yeah. Indeed. Yeah. I get it. So okay. So you guys are still having fun. We kind of, I know we digress a lot. So, and here I'm trying to.
We still have 7 watching, which because I think you know it's. I mean, it's not like we're just talking in vain. You're working hard all the time.
Well, 7 is a good number. So. And people can watch it afterwards. Oh, what am I doing? How am I going to do this speed thing? It should have some. So B, E.
B, yes.
So hold on. Where are my paint tools? Paint tools, where are you? Not here. So.
Wouldn't you start doing the loop now and then see how it sensibly connects?
Yeah, I think so. Okay. I don't know. Maybe going for because it's the thing. I'm thinking about the kind of shape. I know what this reminds me of. Cartier.
Yeah, don't worry about that.
Okay, and I'm not worried about that. Even though I'm kind of asking myself, what kind of B should I do? That's why I was hoping that my paint tools would work. But anyway,
your paint tools?
Yeah, I don't know why I used them just a little bit ago. Maybe
maybe off screen.
Maybe I threw them where I shouldn't. I don't know. Anyhow. I'm going to be just playing wacky and see where that gets me. You guys are going here. I can do this the worst way possible.
Yeah.
Oh, come on. Get out. Oh, you're already out.
That's interesting. Are you going to do like a blob in the middle of the loop between the two?
Yeah.
I was thinking that it could work to sort of echo the blob in the R, right?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking about, like having a loop like here, around here, right?
Mm-hmm.
Let's see how that goes. So this is the bottom one, should be top, and this is the top one, so it should be like this. Sorry. So where will this connect? Oh, it should connect somewhere around here, I guess. Actually, they're inverted. So you go there, you go there. All of a sudden, this got cute, didn't it?
Say again.
Like the whole feeling, all of a sudden, is getting cute.
Yes, it starts looking like more of a sort of flowery, sort of playful.
It does, doesn't it? Okay, let's keep it that way.
Yeah, I think it's good because, you know, given how you as a Portuguese person are generally very solemn and serious, then a bit playfulness is never out
never
of
that
place.
There you go.
Oh, that is a nice shape. That it could be some dingbat in the middle. arabesque of some sort.
So, I don't know why, but today I'm kind of silent during this.
Because it takes
more concentration. I don't know.
Maybe
it does.
Okay.
Sorry?
No. Just carry on. It's interesting to watch me. The torment that you're sort of now going through.
Vocalizing it.
Me sort of silently saying the full version of the famous abbreviation WTF. What are you doing? They just get on with the bloody second loop, and then you can.
I will. Yeah, I'm way too worried about it. Yeah. You're absolutely right. Okay, so this guy will be. I was kind of wondering here. You know, if there would be, you know, actually a better way to do this. Because it's a thing. I haven't seen much of people, you know, just drawing.
Scripts,
you know, on the go.
I do have a feeling that this is not the most efficient.
I think so.
Way, but also okay. Well, yeah, that's.
This is all testing.
Of course.
I don't know if this is going to go well or not. So, and I haven't done my share, you know, my big share. Formal scripts, even though this is getting out of that realm, but it does retain some properties. But then again, it's pretty much the same. It depends on the time that one dedicates to it.
It's mind-bogglingly ugly. It's terrible.
I kind of like the idea.
This looks like the German SZ uppercase something. It's absolutely hideous.
Yeah.
This is the most hideous B that I've seen in a long time. It sort of equals in ugliness the Google logo.
Okay.
Wait, it has no. It's forced. No, it's. Are you sure? I mean, no. Just seriously, are you sure about this starting off the?
No, I'm not sure of anything.
Yeah, the bottom.
Actually, I don't know how this can go. Well, yeah, this is all of a sudden. This is getting a very American.
Yes, it is. It is going. Try to do the following. If you concentrate on the loop, on the right side. Try to do again the same thing that you just grab the middle part, I would say the middle loop, and move it radically to a different place. You know, just grab the whole middle loop and everything.
No.
Yeah, well, and then sort of, well, not as radical, of course, but, but sort of,
hold on.
You know, move it, for instance, to the X height. Oh, maybe, yeah, maybe, you know, but this is where I think. Because the, you know, the stem part is kind of always, there's less character in it. But I think how you shape the loops, whether the top one is is very small and the bottom one is very big, or vice versa. I think that is sort of having the most impact on the letter.
Well, I don't know. I'm getting to a whole Anna Barbera kind of thing.
Yeah, what if you, well, if you move the whole loop construction towards the X height and make the, just the, you know, a more pronounced contrast in sizes, what would you feel about that?
Well, I like it's a lowercase b.
Just the whole cross section, the whole loop towards, that's the other thing, is basically, the proportions basically also. You know, I think it was too big. Well, that's a bit too, but it might be, yeah. And now grab the cross section and move it up. Instead of do it the loop thing, just sort of towards.
I'm not enjoying this idea of the loop, actually.
You're not enjoying? No. The loop thing, or?
Yeah, I'm not feeling it.
Even though there's
something here. Yeah.
If you reduce the loop a bit, make it really to sort of it start looking like a blob, so we get the feeling of the inner portion.
This needs to go. Okay. That's the thing. I can see definitely there's something going on here, something interesting going on here, but I'm not very convinced. On where this is going. So, you know, I do like the chubby, the chubby feel it has.
What if you made also, because you know, for some reason I am a, if you took the top counter, sort of the top stem of the B and moved it in and basically make an even more pronounced difference in the size, so the top one would be really smaller than the bottom one. I think it would help. I feel.
Yeah, it might.
Well, maybe not that much. Not to the. No, I meant, I think, horizontally. Basically, if you grab the left, the right. Yeah, in the other. Yeah, basically.
I'm just looking for stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know, actually.
It's sort of, we did, I must admit, we did lose some it is hard.
It is. Well, we can always see. Well, we can always do the cheat and see how other people have done it. So,
indeed.
Look the logos. So I don't know. Let me check. This is the kind of thing I was trying to avoid. Oh, surreal tonight. Yeah, but yeah, it seems like a standard way of doing it.
Yes. And so that's where you were going. I see. So that's where you were going with the. Well, but that. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I was actually my first idea is what if I had a lowercase b that I could, you know, in some way scale it up. but yeah, that's not going to work. So, with that said,
What if you really try to grab that portion that now is the pseudo stem and make it into into that, into basically a, you know, a roof of sorts.
Maybe I left way too much. I gave way too much room for experimentation. You know, but I haven't been doing this for some time. So.
Yeah, but it already start looking promising, I must say.
Yeah, I know.
It's.
I had the same thing. The same feeling out of it. Maybe not. We'll get there. The trick is never too bad.
Yeah, and what if you congest that that loop to that black blob as well, just like you did in the R? I have a maybe it will be a bit odd because it already is dark there, but I just. You know, so that it actually.
I think I'll go black with it. You know, in the sense I'll do something like this. I just think I have to tighten this more.
Yes. I agree.
So it isn't this much of a thing. But anyway.
Although if it's a slightly exaggerated, then just like the R, so it actually has the same kind of blobby size like the blob in the R, it wouldn't be bad, I think. But maybe I'm...
Yeah, but you don't have... Well,
I know what you mean. Yeah, because it sort of touches two black strokes, so I know that you're sort of trying to...
And you have another shape there, you know, that it's closer to a droplet than this kind of loop. But I don't know. Let's see where this goes. Man, this is hard. So for everybody
put a stem there, I would
already
say. Okay. Yeah, because then we can see how much actually what the width, how much the width of the B, for instance, because you know the point is it can be a pseudo stem like this, and now you can sort of start, for instance, moving it in, and seeing how narrow optically you actually want the B, because that also is dramatic. See, that is a dramatic sort of influence over the whole, because I feel that it could be fairly narrow, you know, more narrow than we originally thought, and then the loopy parts or the, you know, the swashes can sort of go out and be crazy, but actually I would even move it slightly more in. I would even push it, you know, well, maybe not that, but sort of,
but actually this might work.
Yeah, but sort of in the, maybe not as close, but just a bit, but sort of, you know, thereabouts. And isn't that too, what's the thickness right now?
It's around 80, I guess. No, it's 90.
Okay. Isn't it a bit too?
Yeah.
And you know what you could, because I have always have a feeling that, No. That's the thing. You know, when you move it out, it becomes American instantly, right? When you move it out to the left, it sort of starts looking like Budweiser, basically. If you move it in, then it sort of starts looking more kind of elegant and yeah. Interesting. Yeah. No.
What? You think so?
It already looks like that. Does look like sort of Jovica Veljovic, but it doesn't fit the style of it. It's not a bad thing to look like. Yeah. I would. Nah, that's too much. But yeah. I kind of like it. Like it. And I would tilt the I would instantly, I would tilt the stem a bit to the left, right? Because it needs not that much maybe, but sort of, because it's there's this optical.
Actually, I don't know if it's good for who's watching, you know, like me working with six.
So have seven. Easier. Yeah, I would. Right? We have seven people. And you need to lose that contrast now. I think you need to thinner. Oh, that's where you go. Okay, I see. Okay, yeah, makes sense. Does make sense, yes.
Yeah, I think so. Let's see. Ooh, I don't know. Actually, I'm not very happy with this.
Well, you need to lose the contrast early, right? Because it now become to basically make it a bit more pronounced. The inner curve needs to be a bit more squared than the outer one. So mm-hmm. that you get this modulation of a pen that is held vertically, pretty much. Horizontally, horizontal nib, because right now it was still a bit angular. So the contrast, I think. That looks like some other American thing.
Yeah.
Mountain Dew or something. Oh, yeah. Nice. Very good. See how instantly you can basically turn, you know, champagne into mountain equipment. You just put a long stroke across and it starts looking like something you go out for mountains and Rutlers. Actually, it's now Rutler or something. The good American Rutler, you know, go to Rocky Mountain.
Yeah, but this kind of thing, actually, it's...
Kill a grizzly bear with your bare hands, Rutler.
Actually, I don't know. No, I don't know.
It's... No.
I know, but I had to try it. Even worse.
Sure. Make it superscript. Oh yeah, that is No. Okay, that is
Cutler. No, with a K. I don't know. So, formal script guys, respect, a lot of respect.
Indeed, yes.
This is hard stuff to do. Oh. I don't know.
This sort of starts looking like a German thing.
Okay,
you know,
let's...
Like a Scharf SS. Yes. What did you do? Are you crazy?
No. I think I'll go for a lowercase one and that's it.
No, come on. No,
because we're running out of time.
Okay.
It's
okay. Good call.
Okay, so good. I should start for the L. I don't know. Maybe this is disappointing, right? But
no, it's not. It's, you know, it's basically what is it? The, you know, any failure is just a learning experience, right?
Indeed. So what I've learned is formal script people and a lot of respect. Mm-hmm. So my props to you. Actually, no, I'm not doing this.
Would you reuse the? Oh, okay, no, sorry.
And I'm just reusing the curve there.
Yeah.
So are you keeping an eye on the comments? Because I don't want to ignore people.
A few people have tuned out. We have 5 watching now, but no comments. I think they're all kind of
resistant 5.
Oh, well, the sort of, I think the enjoying, you know, watching somebody fail, it's like the most basically this could be, you know, given the fact that most YouTube videos are, you know, people falling over, falling off roofs, slipping on banana skins and something, this could be included in the, you know, 2015 failures of the year.
I'm cool with it. How are we doing? Well, this is the sloppy way to do it, right? Just okay. Actually, this is not that bad. No, I do like this angle here. But does it work well?
It doesn't have anything to do with formal script.
It doesn't, not even a little bit.
Wouldn't you take the L and make it the L loop instead of a straight one? Just to make a, you know, start with the, just take the L and...
like doing it the other way around
No, just going from, you know, going down and up again. Just one movement, so taking the L and... for the straight stem, so not having this, because it's all, you know, downwards. You don't do in formal script, you don't do the up movement. It's sort of
Oh, yeah, I see what you mean.
You don't bounce off the bottom and
yeah, I get it. So yeah, it was like stopping a little bit upper.
Yeah, but grab the L, no?
Yeah, I will.
Okay. Sorry, I didn't want to.
But instead of, yeah, well, let's try that out. Yeah, but even though I don't know if this works.
It has to work. It's flat, so you need to loosen the contrast there in the.
Sorry.
Yeah. It was. You were going in the right direction. You were going in the right direction.
Yeah.
It is good direction. It is good.
You think so? I don't know. This is kind of. I don't know. I'm just at this point.
No, right now you sort of start, like your mind starts giving up, but it's actually good. It's good direction. You now just need to, you know, find the place where the thinning should occur and make it a bit more square, I would say, but just on that right bottom. Yeah. Just push it.
No.
Yeah, that's too... No. I just meant the sort of the bottom right corner, because Yeah, because you have this tendency. You know, it should come a bit more square. The two BCPs.
Hold on.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. And now, you know, now you can find.
Now I can find this spot.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this guy should go squarish.
Yeah.
This guy maybe should go up. Maybe a little bit more pronounced than the other ones. This guy should definitely go down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This should be around here. And I do believe that the same should happen here. even though
it's maybe a bit too, wider, I think it's a yeah. bit too congested.
Even though to get this, like
in a yeah, it needs to sort of sit somewhere in the E proportions, yes.
So then again, this guy also has to go up. So this can square a bit. I don't know.
It is good.
It's getting there.
It's a good direction. It's good. It's a good direction.
Even though, yeah, I see what you mean. Somewhere here.
And something needs to grow a bit balls because it's now getting very thin. So somewhere needs to be a bit more flesh, but maybe the left bottom could actually be even a bit more squarish. So it's sort of to grow. Yeah. To grow some meat.
Yeah.
Could even go with the outer, still a bit more outside. Sorry, the lower left outer contour, I would sort of make it a bit.
Yeah.
Just so that there is this meat that basically it's a slow movement there. Because it has to be a slow movement, because you're actually doing a long loop, so you would naturally sort of, because it's basically when you're writing, and you're doing with something like you're going down, you sort of naturally speed up because you're already on you're finishing the stroke, so you speed up. Yeah. But if you're going down and you still have a full loop ahead, then you're going slower, and therefore the corner becomes slightly more kind of congested. So there's still something to be fiddled there, but I kind of like it.
I can see where this is going, but
what if you took it, take just if you take the left two nodes of the upright stroke, the two nodes of the upright stroke, the left ones, just the very yeah no no not this one just the just,
just the, left the upright node.
Yeah. So just take the top and the top and the bottom node of the out of the leftmost stroke.
The
top corner. Yeah. The top left corner. Not these two nodes. Vertically. This one and the one below.
Okay.
And move them. See how, because the, so to find, I'm looking at the small window, the preview, but I feel that this, this can be a tad thicker than the L stem and the rest.
Yeah.
And then it sort of gets the, the right kick. Don't you agree?
Yeah, it does get it does assume the function of an uppercase.
What you can do now is actually, if you're not happy, because I would grab the other two nodes of the other side of that stem and move them there a bit. So basically, you have something of an optical cheat there. Basically, mm-hmm. the right, yeah, these just the two, the top one and the one below. Sorry. This one and the one below it, and move them a few units to the left.
Let's see what you mean. Yeah, to get them in.
Yeah. So basically, you get that bit of the meat that is needed, you know, that the stem, well, the optically, the top part is of the same thickness as the rest, but that part in the loop is a bit thicker, so you kind of, yeah. This is, you know, you agree or not with the...
Yeah, I do. I think it works.
Because it makes the B portion sort of gain that strength again that it's lost due to the different distribution of the weight there.
Hmm.
Well, anyhow, that. Oh yeah, and that's sort of the more or less the beauty of the upright working method, right? With the slant that you can just move up and down, and you don't have to worry about the slanted grid or something.
How tall is this? Okay, so it's just bye, and it needs that guy just there. I don't know. Yeah, maybe something like that. Well, even though I would call, I would call this a wrap.
That was a marathon.
That was a marathon. even though I don't know if you guys have some questions or.
We have three watching now. A few of them left because I think that prolonged B marathon should actually probably, you know, it would basically deserve an episode on its own.
it would. But even though for the guys on the left.
Oh, it's a yeah. Okay.
Like the resistant people.
Yes.
So
our faithful audience, the ones who have not abandoned us, we are very, very grateful.
Do you guys have any questions and anything that?
If you have any questions, type them into the chat. There is a bit of a delay, so.
Okay. We'll wait a little bit then.
Wanted to say that other than that, we will be indeed wrapping up. What did you do?
I just lent it in, you know, back to the values and got the
Yeah, that's the final, exactly. Well, it didn't come out so bad, I must say.
It had its own time.
No, but I mean, you know, after the battle, I mean, after the long...
Yeah?
The long march, I think the bottom part of the B is still a bit not quite there, but... You know.
We could be tweaking this endlessly.
Indeed.
And probably it's not the point. So.
No. I think you've it wasn't an easy challenge. It was not an easy challenge.
Yeah.
It's formal script, you know. It takes years of practice.
Yeah, because you read right, of course. And also it's not my
area of specialty.
So, yeah, of course. So it's not my milieu, but which is actually nice, you know, because I get to challenge myself a bit.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, not that bad. You know, because all of a sudden I have this tendency to make it softer or not as respectful or respectful tone. And it's that. And also, there are people that do brilliant stuff with formal script.
Have you ever practiced formal script by hand?
That's one of the issues also. I haven't.
Mm.
So
yeah, you know, that is, I mean, I think the, you know, of course, the this notion, this is the category where, of course, the tool sort of dictates a lot of the rules. And, well, it can be basically either you practice or you just, and I must say that, you know, in addition to just practicing, also just looking a lot at the results, at good penmanship, also helps, because the, you know, the visual memory works as well. So, as you said, somewhere in the middle, you know, if you sort of out of, if you're looking for an idea, just sort of look at good examples, and then you'll see, it does make sense. This is the good direction. So there's no shame in that, right? There is no shame.
No, of course not.
That's the whole point, that basically if it's a established style, you want to sort of see where the rules are and maybe where you can sort of break them a bit to add your own personal flavor.
Sure, of course, that's the thing. And well, I don't believe anyone comes out with something, you know, out of the blue. It's well, and that's the thing. It takes years of practice and a lot of looking, at least you know where stuff is, because usually, I don't know. Even now, you know, there are a lot of things that one does that it's pretty much naive. You know, it's not even conscious at all.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that overlaying of visual culture and basically looking at stuff. So
yeah, but that's true. I think looking at analog, for instance, really at analog, you know, penmanship books is really helpful, because the digital can sort of cheat, because you're looking at something that is a rehash of a rehash of a rehash, and certain aspects got lost, and sort of looking at penmanship books is really good.
Yeah, that's the thing. That's it. I completely agree with you.
Yeah, well,
I think let's hold this up. And,
it was a good 100th edition, I think.
It is. It was nice. But even though I would like to check. We have stuff going on. Hey. So where what is going?
Yeah, we did. I was. That's already a few minutes out, so there wasn't any extra questions.
Okay.
I think we may reconvene at another session.
Yeah, we'll do. This is more than everything. This is much of a. This is more a test session than anything. So I don't even know if I'm going to publish this out. But even though, I think this is a test, and I do believe it's a good way to start. Let's see.
It was good.
You
sound a bit exhausted, but you really sound like after a good workout. So I think I'll let you take a break and take a refreshment.
Yeah, that's the thing. I'm there was as well as someone was saying that who was it? Enjoying the battle from India. So I think this was pretty much, you know, the struggle thing. So
yes.
We had fun, we had drama, we had. But maybe it was a good show.
Exactly, it was a perfect episode. It was a perfect. We had everything. We had love, drama, struggle, humor. Let's leave it at that and see and talk to each other the next time.
Okay,
and our audience.
Yeah, that's the thing. So, well, for everybody watching, thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed.
I hope this was interesting for you guys. And we'll see you in the next one. I don't know if Adam's going to join or not, but I'm hoping to do this way more regularly. And I don't know, if you guys...
Nope. Looks like we lost your sound or something. I think it's calls for a break. To anyone listening... we lost you for a moment.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yes. So, Fábio, thanks a lot.
Yeah.
And...
well, thank you. Thank you for saying for going forward with a completely impromptu session. So thank you very much, man.
Always a pleasure.
Okay, thanks, man. And to everyone, wherever you are, so have a really good day. And thanks a lot for showing up.
Thank you, guys. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.